say happy Sabbath, everybody.
Happy Sabbath.
Definitely a blessing to stand before you all today. Also, everybody that's tuning in, thank you for tuning in today. Sorry for the problem with the internet or the difficulty we had streaming, but we should be up and running now. So, just want to come before you all and tell you all that I am grateful to stand before you and deliver the word of God to you, raw and uncut. Once again, I thank the Lord for allowing me to bring you the gospel after the Lord's own heart, not after my own heart, not after how they would do it in the Sunday church. I thank the Lord for not taking me down that path. So with that said, we just want to thank the Lord for allowing us to see another Sabbath day, and thank the Lord for allowing us to have understanding on what it is we're supposed to do regarding not only his Sabbath day, but all the Sabbaths that he set aside for us to observe. Because we're getting ready to come into a time that the world is getting ready to observe days that have not been set aside by the Lord. Not only do you have tomorrow, Sunday, that a lot of people take part in, not knowing that they're worshiping the God of this world that went all the way back to the days of Egypt and Babylon, and also the holidays that they're getting ready to come into, that they celebrate through ignorance. The next major one they have coming up is Halloween. And a lot of people gonna have their kids out trick-or-treating, not understanding what trick-or-treating is all about, not understanding what the costumes are about, not understanding or having an idea of what it is that they partaking in. And the very God that they love warned them to learn not to wear the heathen. And it just so happened that some of these things that they're taking part in goes absolutely against what the Lord told us in the scriptures. So our job, once again, is to make sure as watchmen is that we sound the alarm. That way the people will be warned before destruction comes. You know, a lot of people, they get ready to take part in these holidays and things that have nothing to do with the Lord, but they think they're doing this thing in righteousness. And ain't nothing righteous about a lot of this stuff that's going on, brothers and sisters. So what we got to do as watchmen is, like I said, make sure we sound the alarm and make sure we keep this horn blowing. So before the Lord does make his return, or before the Lord calls it the end, a lot of people won't have the excuse to say that they didn't know. Because just like we come before you by way of mouth with the word of God, that's your warning right there. When you go online and look on YouTube, you see brothers teaching, or when you live stream in certain classes, or if you talk with somebody in your workplace, when you give them that word, that person is being warned at that point in time. It's just up to them to see whether they're going to go further and start digging to see what it is they're supposed to do in order to get salvation. Because Satan is running rampant today, brothers and sisters. He is running real, and he's running fast, and he's trying to get as many people as he can to join him in that lake of fire. This thing is coming down real fast, brother and sister, and it's important that you pay attention to what's going on. But the more and more we start seeing that this thing get ready to come down, the more and more you're going to start seeing that man of sin. You're going to start seeing his colors. You're going to start seeing his attributes and how he acts. It's not going to be hidden anymore. It's not going to be hidden up under the name of the Holy Roman Emperor, or the Holy Roman Empire. You're going to start seeing who this man is, and you're going to start being able to tie some of the things that the world celebrates to him and his doctrine and where he gets it from. So with that said, brothers and sisters, the title of this lesson today is called The Antichrist Doctrines Are Many. The Antichrist Doctrines Are Many. And by it being so many, the original title of this lesson was called The Antichrist Doctrine. And my wife said something to me yesterday. She said, Why you call it that? He said, because that's just general, and there's so many doctrines that fall up under that Antichrist doctrine, we wouldn't be able to cover all of them. So I thought about it. I said, well, why not change it to the Antichrist doctrines are many. So what we're going to do is we're going to deal with some of them. Some of them you may be familiar with, some of them you may not be familiar with. But our job is to go through them, look at them. And even if we may be edified already in what's going on, there's people that do watch us online, and look at our videos online, who just coming into the Word of God and don't have understanding on what it is that they partake in. So what we're going to do, brothers and sisters, we're going to open this thing up in the book of Timothy. We're going to go in 2 Timothy chapter 3. We're going to pick it up at verse 16. Pray that everybody had their spiritual ears on. Kids, make sure y'all pay attention, because y'all going to be dealing with a lot of this in school. Dealing with a lot of your friends. You're going to deal with people coming to your house, knocking on your door. As kids, you may come in contact with other kids, and you can tell them the truth. You know, when they ask you why y'all don't celebrate Halloween, you can tell them why. Why y'all don't celebrate Christmas, you can tell them why. Certain things y'all do that they don't do, if you pay attention, you'll be able to tell them why you don't do what the world does. Alright? So 2 Timothy chapter 3, we're going to pick it up at verse 16. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16, when you get it, brother, go ahead and read.
All scriptures are given by inspiration of God, and is profitable for doctrine.
Go ahead.
For reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness.
That's right, brother and sister. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, correction, and instruction in righteousness, brother and sister. This scripture is talking about the Old Testament. When these brothers were on the scene at this time, the New Testament was not in existence. So the scripture that he referring to right here is the Old Testament. What you find in the Old Testament, you find the holy days that the Lord set aside for us to do. You find the things that Jesus told Moses to give to the children of Israel and also the stranger that was among them. So this scripture that was given, that was written down by the brothers, it was given by inspiration of God, and it's profitable for doctrine, reproof, correction, for instruction, and righteousness. For what, brother? 17.
That the man of God may be perfect. Through furnished.
Fairly furnished
unto all good works.
That's right, brother and sister. That the man of God may be perfect. So in order for you to be perfect, brother and sister, you got to find the scriptures. And the scriptures going to tell you what it is you're supposed to do and what it is you ain't supposed to do. Let's go with Isaiah chapter 8. Isaiah chapter 8. I did not eat a good breakfast this morning. I ate a light breakfast, so I am light-headed. So I will be talking pretty slow. Not what I'm teaching. Isaiah chapter 8. In verse 16, what does it say, brother? Hold on 1 second. Let us get it. Isaiah chapter 8. You got to find Isaiah? Isaiah chapter 8 and verse 16. When you get it, brother, go ahead and read.
Bind up the testimony, seal the law among my disciples.
Go ahead.
And I will wait upon the Lord that hideth his face from the house of Jacob, and I will look for him.
Okay, so the scripture said, Isaiah 8:16, bind up the testimony, seal the law among my disciples. When you seal something, you close it off. So the disciples ain't going to come with nothing new. Whatever you find in the Old Testament, that's what's going to be spoken about in the New Testament. The disciples ain't going to come and change what was given. The book say, bind up the testimony and seal the law among my disciples. Now notice something, brothers and sisters, we're in the Old Testament. This is Jesus talking, because God the Father never had disciples. Jesus is the one that had disciples. So he said, bind up the testimony and seal the law among my disciples. Skip down to verse 20, go ahead.
To the law and to the testimony.
To the law and to the testimony, the Old Testament and the New Testament, come on.
If they speak not according to this word.
If they speak not according to this word, go ahead.
It is because there is no light in them.
That's right, brother and sister. So if they speaking and telling you to do things outside this this book, it ain't no light in them. That light represents what? Understanding. Ain't no understanding in them, brother and sister. And sometimes, you know, I deal with a lot of people myself trying to get me off track. You know, like I said, they try to get me to answer questions with my own opinion. But I just can't do it because, you know, I'm a fallible man. And we do fall all the time, brothers and sisters. But I just try to make sure I answer you according to the Word of God. And you will see that when you do that, answer things according to the Word of God, then your understanding will be increased greatly. And also on top of that, you can't go wrong dealing with the Word of God. All right, so let's go over to 2 Peter. Pick it up at chapter 1. So he said, to the law and to the testimony. If they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no life in them. The book also tells you, judge the tree by the fruit that it bears. You can tell that by the conversation. You can tell by how they, where they carry themselves. You can tell what it is they put inside their body. You can tell what it is they eat. You can tell if they eat from the table of the Lord, or you can tell if they eat from the table of Satan. Just by what it is that comes out of their mouth. So go and pick it up at, we're going to go to 2 Peter chapter 1 and pick it up at verse 16. And then skip down to verse 19. And go ahead.
Because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy.
Hold on 1 second. Second Peter chapter 1.
Well, we have not followed cunning device fables.
And we haven't followed those either, brothers, since we did at a time. And right now, we don't follow cunningly devised fables. A lot of the fables that are going on in the world today, brothers and sisters, are some of the holidays that are taking place. Those are fables, lies, vanity. Have nothing to do with the word of God. So like he's saying that we have not followed cunningly devised fable. Cunningly is something they actually really took their time on how they can deceive people. Cunningly devised fables. And that's what's going on, brothers and sisters, in the world today. Now all these things that a lot of people taking part in, these are cunningly devised fables. And we're going to look at some of those today. Go and read, brother.
When we made known unto you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of his majesty.
That's right. Skip down to verse 19.
We have also a more sure word of prophecy.
That's right. We have also a more sure word of prophecy. The prophecy is in the Old Testament. Go ahead.
Whereunto ye do well that ye take heed.
That's right. So take heed to the prophecy, brother. So sit back. Sit all the way back. Take heed to the prophecy. Take heed to what the brother was coming with out of the word. He said, whereunto you do well that ye take heed as what?
As unto a light that shineth in dark places. Until the day dawn and the day star rise in your heart.
That's right, come on.
Knowing this first,
go ahead,
that no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation.
That's right, no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation. Go ahead and read.
For the prophecy came not in old times by the will of man.
That's right, go
but
ahead.
Holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost.
Then we just read all scripture is given by inspiration of God.
Right.
So the prophets, Ezekiel, Isaiah, Daniel, all them brothers, they was moved by inspiration of God. It wasn't their own private interpretation. So it would be wise for us to go back and see what it is that the Lord told them to do. And what he left in the book that those brothers had to write down for us to be able to get eternal life. Don't be deceived by the cunningly devised fables. They've been going on for a long time, brothers and sisters. All right, so let's go over to Exodus chapter, Daniel 7, I'm sorry. Daniel chapter 7. Daniel chapter 7. We're going to look at this little horn that's going to make war against the saints at a set time when the Lord gave him rulership on this earth, which is also the abomination of desolation or the man of sin or the son of perdition. But we're going to look at some of the things that he's going to try to do, which he's also doing today. Daniel chapter 7 verse 21. Go ahead and read, bro.
I beheld, and the same horn made war with the saints and prevailed against them.
Go ahead.
Until the Ancient of Days came, and judgment was given to the saints of the Most High.
Go ahead.
And the time came that the saints possessed the kingdom.
The saints did what?
Possessed the kingdom.
Go ahead.
Thus he said, the fourth beast shall be the fourth kingdom upon earth, which shall be diverse from all kingdoms, and shall devour the whole earth.
That's right. So this fourth beast is going to be different from all the other beasts. And this last beast that we're up under right now is called the Roman Empire. This is the one that Daniel could not see. It's just called the great and dreadful, a terrible beast. It had no description. All the other ones had description. You had the lion. You had what else? You had the lion, You had the bear,
the eagle,
and the eagle, right?
Right, and the leopard.
And the leopard, right. So the lion with eagle's wings,
right?
Bear, then you had the leopard. Yeah, so all of them had names. The last one was a terrible beast, which is this fourth one, which is also not going. Well, first off, they're destroying you spiritually right now. The physical part is getting ready to take place real soon, though. That's why he's a great and terrible beast. Go and read.
And shall tread it down, uh-huh, and break it in pieces.
Go ahead.
And the 10 horns out of this kingdom are 10 kings that shall arise.
That's right. And those 10 kings out of this horn, out of this little horn, already ready and already set to go. Go and read.
And another shall rise after them.
Uh-huh.
And he shall be diverse from the first.
Uh-huh.
And he shall subdue 3 kings.
Right. Well, this first one, the 24 right here, that represent Rome falling 10 times. And we're in that last time of it rising now. Alright? So this ain't talking about the 10 kings that formed last year. This is talking about the rise and fall of the Roman Empire. 10 times. Go and read.
And he shall speak great words against the Most High.
He shall speak great words against the Most High. Everything the Most High told us to do in order to get salvation, he gonna speak otherwise. So you can't get salvation. Alright, go ahead and read.
And shall wear out the saints of the Most High.
He gonna wear out the saints of the Most High. Go ahead.
And think to change times and laws.
That's right. So the Lord say Saturday is the Sabbath day, he gonna tell you Sunday. Lord told you to honor my death, he's going to say, nah, we're going to honor his birth on December 25th. Ain't got nothing to do with the Lord. Lord told you to keep the Passover, he said, we're going to keep Easter. Lord say, Jesus told him, disciple, he's going to raise him up at the last day. He said, nah, when you die, you go off to heaven. You're going to speak great words against the Most High. Go and read.
And they shall be given into his hand,
uh-huh,
until a time and a times and the dividing of time.
That's right. That's during the time when this Roman emperor or this abomination desolation get 3.5 years to rule the world. He's going to come against the saints, brothers and sisters. But we want to try to shed a light on that so people can kind of wake up and see what's going on so they don't get caught up in this time. And this time is coming. This time is coming. It's kind of hard to go to even go without teaching a lesson about what's going on, because it's happening so much. Even if you're teaching a lesson on marriage, you still see in the Bible what's going on around you with the current events. So it's hard to teach a lesson without saying something about what's happening right before us. That's how fast it's coming. So as a watchman, you don't want to pass up opportunity. So, to warn people. So now let's go over to Exodus 20. Exodus 20, we're going to pick it up at verse 1. Exodus 20, when the children of Israel came out of Egypt, the Lord gave them the 10 commandments, which is the royal commandments or the royal law of what they were supposed to do. And Moses had them on that table of stone to put before the people. But let's see what took place. Go ahead and read Exodus 20.
And God spake all these words, saying,
uh-huh,
I am the Lord thy God, which have brought thee out of the land of Egypt,
uh-huh,
out of the house of bondage.
Get down to verse 8.
Remember the Sabbath day it holy.
All right, so these are the 10 commandments. The Lord said, remember the Sabbath day to do what?
Keep it holy.
Go ahead and read.
6 days shall thou labor,
uh-huh,
and do all thy work.
Go ahead.
But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God.
You sure it ain't the first day? Okay, so it says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shall thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. Go ahead.
In it thou shalt not do any work,
uh-huh,
thou, nor thy son, nor thy daughter,
uh-huh,
thy manservant, nor thy maidservant,
uh-huh,
nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates.
Go ahead.
For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth,
uh-huh,
the sea, and all that in them is,
uh-huh,
and rested the seventh day.
Go ahead.
Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it.
That's right, brother and sister. The Lord blessed the seventh day and hallowed it. He didn't bless the first day and hallow that first day. He didn't sanctify that day. It was the seventh day. Before we even came into existence, this day was already set aside. Before the Lord even took the children of Israel and put them in the wilderness, this day was already set aside. So how is it that we let somebody tell us, because Paul and the other brothers came together on the first day of the week, now that's the time that we're supposed to worship on and supposed to rest on? But that's what's being said. But that comes from Satan the devil. We're going to find it out. Let's go over to Genesis chapter 2 and pick it up at verse 1. Genesis chapter 2. Genesis chapter 2. You there?
Yeah?
Good. Genesis chapter 2. And verse 1, when you get it, go ahead and read, brother.
Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the host of them.
Go ahead.
And on the seventh day, God ended his work which he had made. And he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had made.
Read that again. He did what?
And on the seventh day, God ended his work which he had made.
On the seventh day, we looking at, I want to read that again because I want you to see. We ain't see no first in that day. We saw on the seventh day. Go ahead and read.
And he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had made.
That's right. Go ahead and read, brother.
And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it.
Go ahead.
Because that in it he had rested from all his work which God created and made.
That's right, brother and sister. Now understand something. When you understand the scriptures, you'll see that chapter 1 is actually a blueprint. The Lord has not rested yet. That was his plan. When you get into chapter 2, then you're gonna see, you'll see that all the things that he spoke of in chapter 1 starts coming into play. But when sin entered into the garden, Jesus didn't rest. Because the whole time since sin came on the scene, then the whole plan is to get man back to becoming a God. As long as we dying in the flesh and blood, we ain't a God yet. So that's work that the Lord is still doing until he actually comes back on his day of rest. So let's go look at that, because we need to be laboring to try to get into that day of rest, brothers and sisters. But it ain't took place yet. It says that, but that was a blueprint. The Lord ain't going to have 2 days of rest. He going to have 1 day of rest, which he had set aside in the beginning, but Adam and Eve sinned, like I said. And by that taking place, death was put on the table, and we've been drinking of that cup ever since. Psalm 95. And pick it up at verse 7. And this is when the Lord was dealing with the children of Israel in the wilderness. And he spoke of a certain day. We're going to see what that day is. Psalm 95 and verse 7. Go ahead, brother.
For he is our God. And we are the people of his pasture.
Go ahead.
And the sheep of his hand. Today, if ye will hear his voice, harden not your heart, as in the provocation, and as in the day of temptation in the wilderness.
Go ahead. So he said, what now? No, harden not your heart, as in the provocation, as in the day of temptation in the wilderness. Go ahead.
When your fathers tempt me, prove me,
go ahead,
and saw my work, 40 years long was I grieved with this generation, and said, it is a people that do err in their heart,
go ahead,
and they have not known my way.
That's right. So he said, this is the people that do err in their heart, and they have not known my ways. What else he said, brother?
Until whom I swear in my wrath that they should not enter into my rest.
So that other word for rest, brothers and sisters, that is Sabbath. They would not enter into his Sabbath. Now they may get up on the second resurrection, but they ain't getting up on that first resurrection. That first resurrection when Jesus get back, that represent the seventh day. But he said, he swear in his wrath, they would not enter into his rest. So now let's go over to Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 4. Because the reason why we got to go here to see what was he just talking to them about that specific time. Was there a rest for the children of Israel when they came out of the wilderness? When they went into the kingdom, did they rest then at that time? If that's the case, then we shouldn't have Hebrews 4 sitting right here before us. Hebrews 4 and chapter 1, verse 1. What does it say, bro?
Let us therefore fear lest a promise being left us of entering unto his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it.
That's right. So now we see that Paul saying, let us therefore fear, unless a promise of us enter into his rest, we end up coming short of it. So we just see that they got cut off in the rest too. So now Paul is telling us about this same rest. Go ahead, read, brother.
For unto us was the gospel preached.
So unto us was the gospel preached. Go ahead.
As well as unto them.
As well as unto them. What gospel? The same gospel that we giving out right now by the word of God out of this book is the same gospel they got back in the day. The same gospel. So we talking about the same rest.
All right, go ahead, read, brother. But the word preached did not profit them, for being not being mixed with faith in them that heard it.
And that's how it is today, brothers. So the, people are not mixing faith with the word of God that they hear. The faith that you mix with this word is your works. When you see the word and it, you see what it tells you to do, in order for your faith to actually take part in what you read, then you got to show some action doing it. You can't just look at it Sabbath day and say, okay, well, that's a good, nice scripture. You know, it's for everybody else but me. If you believe the word, then your actions don't line up with what the word say. That's your faith. That's why the Bible tell you faith without works is what?
Dead.
Go and read, brother.
Verse 3. For we which have believed do enter into rest. As he said.
Go ahead.
As I have sworn in my wrath, if they shall enter into my rest.
If they shall enter into my rest. Go ahead.
Although the works were finished from the foundation of the world.
That's right. The works were finished from the foundation of the world. But he still ain't rested. That's why he said, if they shall enter into my rest. Even though the foundations was finished from the, what did it say? What we had? Although the works were finished from the foundation of the world. So everything was complete in the beginning, but he still hadn't rested yet. So that's why we're trying to enter into his rest. Go ahead and read, brother.
For he spake in a certain place of the seventh day on this wise, and God did rest the seventh day from all his work.
So he did speak in a certain place of him resting. But what we know of that place where he rested at, that was the blueprint. Go ahead and read.
And in this place again, if they shall enter into my rest.
Right, so he, so what we see here, he said one place he said that he rested on, he rested on the seventh day. Then the other place he said, if they enter into my rest. If you ain't got no understanding, you'll look at it, that and be confused. And then what you're going to say is, well, all you got to do is do what the Lord say, and then you ain't got to do nothing else. Now you resting with the Lord. That's what you're going to say. And that's what a lot of people in the world say. They don't understand that this rest that he's talking about is his kingdom on the Sabbath day when he get back for the 1,000-year millennium. Go and read.
Verse 6. Seeing therefore it remaineth that some must enter therein, and they too whom it was first preached entered not in because of unbelief.
That's right. So some go into enter into it, and the ones who were preached it earlier would not get into it because of their unbelief. We saw that they did not mix faith with what they heard. Go and read, bro.
Again, he limited a certain day, saying in David,
go ahead.
Today, after so long a time, as it is said, today, if ye will hear his voice, harden not your hearts.
That's right, brother. So you hear his, the day when you hear his voice, harden not your hearts. Go ahead.
For if Jesus had given them rest, then would he not afterward have spoken of another day?
That's right. And then when he spoke of that other day, he said, you won't enter into my rest. So if he would have rested, why would he say my rest? Because he ain't rested himself. Go ahead and read.
There remaineth therefore a rest to the people of God.
That's right. And that's what we're working to get into, brothers and sisters. And that's why this Sabbath day is so important. But the world don't understand that the Sabbath day is important. That's why they keep trying to push off on us the first day of the week. Go ahead and read.
For he that is entered into his rest, he also has ceased from his own works, as God did from his.
That's right, brothers and sisters. Go ahead.
Let us labor, therefore, to enter into that rest.
So you got to work to enter into that rest, brothers and sisters. How? By mixing that faith with what you believe. Them actions got to be mixed with what you believe. Them actions got to be mixed with what we read. They can't just be looking at this stuff and taking it as a joke. Because if you wake up in that lake of fire, believe me, you're going to have an opportunity to think about, man, I should have took it serious. And it's going to be too late at that time. Every day we wake up and have a breath of life in us, we have an opportunity to drink from the, eat from the marriage supper of the lamb. Go ahead, read, brother.
Lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief.
That's right. So we don't want to fall up under that example of the forefathers in the wilderness. All right? So now, what we're going to do is, we're going to go look at something in a history book here. And it's called Satan's Angels Exposed. And we got Lil Nate reading today because it will be a lot of reading on DeMarcus. So until we get some more brothers in, we're going to use the help that we got. So we're going to pick it up at page 55. We want to look at this Sunday. Now, we just seen that the Lord gave us a Sabbath day. We see that it points towards something a lot bigger than what we understand just regarding the weekly Sabbath. It also represents the 1,000-year millennium when Christ going to get back on this earth. It represents his day of rest that we are trying to get into. But let's go see what the Antichrist, or let's go see what the world is saying that goes against it. So we wanted to pick it up. Satan's Angel Exposed, page 55 and 56. And go ahead.
On Wednesday, May 3rd, 1978.
Read the topic.
Worship of the sun began in Egypt.
Worship of the sun began in Egypt. Go ahead.
On Wednesday, May 3rd, 1978, the United States paid...
You need to be reading it louder because you're on camera. They need to be able to hear you when we play this back. So read it louder, please.
On Wednesday, May 3rd, 1978, the United States paid homage to the sun.
The United States paid homage to the sun. How do you spell that, Nate?
H-O-M-A.
No, how do you spell sun?
S-U-N.
So we ain't talking about the sun. Jesus Christ, we talking about the sun that's in the sky. Go ahead and read it.
It was called Sunday.
It was called, spell it?
S-U-N-D-A-Y.
Now, the Sunday is not together. It's sun and day. Two separate words. It was called Sunday. Go ahead.
President Carter flew to Colorado to deliver a speech to the Solar Energy Research Institute. There were sunrise services.
Sunrise services. Go ahead. Don't we have sunrise service during the time of Easter?
Yeah.
Okay. Sunrise service. Go ahead.
And solar displays by both industry and the U.S. Army. About 12,000 people attended the speech making at the Washington Monument. The entire United States population had its attention focused on the sun.
Spell that again.
S-U-N.
Is that in capital letters?
Yes, sir.
Okay, go ahead.
Why? Because national leaders believe the sun offers man's last hope of survival in a day of depleting energy.
So who say I'm the way, the truth, and the life? Didn't Jesus say that?
Mm-hmm.
But they say the sun is what's going to offer us life. Go ahead and read.
The sun is man's last hope for life on this earth.
Go ahead.
Many turned on the sun as odd worship.
Many turned to the sun in awed worship. They were amazed by it. Go ahead.
The worship of the sun is not new. Over 3,000 years ago, the Egyptians worshiped the sun.
Go ahead.
While the Babylonians called the sun Utu.
Utu, okay, go ahead.
The Egyptian called it Ra or Re. The center of worship was at Heliopolis.
Go ahead.
Pharaohs were known as the son of the sun.
S-O-N of the S-U-N. Go ahead.
Sun worship in Egypt gradually spread to the solar cult of Rome.
So now we see that the sun worship from Egypt has now passed over to Rome. Alright? Remember we talk about them, the last empire. Okay? Or this great and terrible beast, this last one. Got his customs all the way back to Babylon. Go ahead.
In the 3rd century A.D., the emperor Heliogabalus,
They got some weird names. Go ahead.
Created the cult Sol Invictus.
He created the cult Sol Invictus. Go ahead.
The unconquered sun.
The unconquered sun.
And in 274 A.D., the emperor
Aurelian
built a large temple in Rome. Sol Invictus.
Right, so they built a large temple for the sun god, okay? Now skip down to the highlighted area right there and read that.
Not only did the Egyptians worship the sun, they also worshiped the moon.
They worshiped the moon, that's where you get Monday from. Go ahead.
The bull, the crocodile, the hawk,
go ahead,
the cow,
wow,
the baboon, the goat, and many other animals.
Wow. Then the Lord tell Adam, we supposed to rule over the animal, he gave us dominion over Adam, but now mankind worshiping the animals. Go ahead, read.
The goat and bull were especially sacred to the Egyptians as representing sexual creative powers.
That's right. So that goat, if y'all ever look at the goat inside the hexagram, y'all see that goat with them horns, got the human face with the goat body inside the hexagram because it represents sex. But I don't know, y'all have to look a little deeper into it. But now let's go look at the last 2 million years, and you're gonna pick it up at the first paragraph on 216. Last 2 million years. First paragraph. Let's see.
No, 216. Right? Well, not this one. Right here.
Organizations.
Go ahead, hurry up. Yeah. Come around this way. Yeah, just that whole paragraph. Let me get there right quick. Page 216. And that's what we got to do, brothers. We got to just, when it comes to the Antichrist doctrine and what a lot of things that are going on, we just have to look at history and see how far this doctrine is really reaching into the world, you know? And it requires reading history. Go ahead and read.
The organization of the church was itself in peril.
Uh-huh.
With parishes grouped into dioceses.
Uh-huh.
It had its own system of law.
So the church had its own system of law. What else?
Its own courts.
Its own courts. Go ahead.
Its own taxes.
Uh-huh.
And tithes.
Go ahead.
A 10% levy on the produce of all land.
Right, so they had a 10% levy on all produce of all land. You had your own produce, but you had to pay 10% to them. Go ahead.
Its clergy claimed exemptions.
Their preachers claimed exemption from what?
From paying taxes to kings or emperors.
Uh-huh.
And from being tried by secular courts.
Those are worldly courts. Alright, even though they had their own courts, they claimed exemption. They couldn't be tried by the worldly courts. That's how the Vatican is set up. They can't be tried by nobody else as long as they get back inside Vatican City. And even if he wanted to really stretch his rule, he can get all his popes off anyway, no matter where they at, because he really run the whole world. Go ahead and read.
Their churches could even offer sanctuary.
Uh-huh.
To the king's enemies.
Go ahead.
Clergy could punish the disobedient.
The clergy could do what?
Punish.
Uh-huh.
The disobedient.
Punish the disobedient. Go ahead.
Fine a man for absence from church.
Y'all get ready. Y'all ready for this? Mm-hmm. Y'all ready for this? Y'all understand what we doing? We worshiping the Lord on the Sabbath like he said. But they had a time where they could fine a man for not coming to church. Go ahead.
Whip a woman
for what?
For doing her washing on a Sunday.
On a Sunday, not on the Sabbath day, but on the first day. Go ahead and read.
And hand over heretics to the state
for what?
For burning.
Right. So when you did went against what they said, they will hand you over to the state to burn you. Go ahead.
Their ultimate weapon was the power to excommunicate,
uh-huh,
to cut a man off from the mercy of Christ.
Go ahead.
And so condemn his soul to eternal torment.
Right, so who gives him that right? Who gives him that power to do that?
Say, the Lord.
Right, but I'm just saying, like, out of their mouths, or we cut you off from the Lord now because you're not worshiping on Sunday. This man don't have his power to do that. He can't tell you if you don't keep Sunday. The Lord say keep the Sabbath day. But we saw that he gonna think to change times and laws. Okay? And through the Roman Empire, that's one of the ways. So now, let's go look at, we're going to go to this book called Constantine's Sword. And we're going to go to page 183. And you should see. Right, this book is called Constantine's Sword, The Church and the Jews. I got it because I really wanted to see what Constantine did to the Jews, but they really mixed history up so bad, it's terrible, but you just get what you can out of it.
As seen in Constantine's originated piety,
uh-huh,
that supreme deity would have been associated with the sun.
Right, the supreme deity would be associated with the sun. Go ahead.
And pagans would have recognized with reason their own solar cult in church and such Christian practice as orientating churches to the east,
uh-huh,
worshiping on Sunday,
uh-huh,
and celebrating the birth of the deity at the winter solstice.
Now, winter solstice, when they worshiping that Sunday or that sun, is during the time of Christmas. Okay? Go ahead and read.
Okay, go on.
Mm-hmm.
That Christians' piety commonly included pagan practices and superstitions would have been part of the broad appeal of the gospel among the less educated.
The least educated. So this gospel that they was going to preach, they was going to take it to the least educated. Who was the least educated?
Israel.
And these are the ones that's pushing the Sunday doctrine. That's why they're filling up more whorehouses than any other nationality of people, because they pushed it to the least educated. Go ahead and read. I think it's some more.
Okay, finish.
Another page. Okay. Now, come on to the other page. 184. That's it.
Of course, the proper cult of Catholicism.
It's called a cult, right? Mm-hmm. They call this a cult. Mm-hmm. Alright, so it says. Of course, the proper cult of Catholicism was what?
Was not yet clearly established as the multiplicity of what would soon be termed heresies indicated.
Go ahead.
Once the impulse is to establish a harmonious brotherhood within a group is reified, discordance from outside, originating with distinct groups, become intolerant.
Right, so they were getting everything set up to get rid of the heresies and all of the ones that went against what they said. Alright, so they was getting that all in line, getting that all together. Go ahead.
The very fluidity of practices
became intolerant. Alright, now let's get down to the highlight.
Christian religion was named first.
Go ahead.
And Roman paganism.
So it's one and the same. Go ahead.
Like all paganism, was referred to as any other cult.
That's right. Go ahead.
The growing influence of Christianity would enhance Constantine's power and diminish his own.
Right. So in order for him to gain the power that he had to use that banner of Christianity. And that's how they're ruling the world today, by Christianity. They go over to other countries and take other people out and set up democracies under what? Christianity. We want you to be free. You have that God-given right to go to worship on whenever you feel like it. That ain't what the Lord say, do though. But they use Christianity as a way to set up or to establish their power. Go ahead.
I like it.
Took place gradually and not all at once.
Hold on, I want to read something. Right here. I want you to read that. Go ahead. Right here. There was a lack of religious clarity.
There was a lack of religious clarity.
There was also a lack of religious clarity in Constantine's own mind. But as he gradually...
So you hear what he said? In Constantine's own mind, there was a lack of religious clarity. So they weren't clear on where they had this thing at. So he had to do something. And he gonna set this thing in order. Go ahead.
But as his gradual accumulation of political power seemed tied to his affiliation with the Christian God, he became firmer over time in that affiliation.
Right. Now he said he had an affiliation with the Christian God. This Christian God is this one God that didn't fall up under Roman Pantheon. Roman Pantheon, listen, man. Roman Pantheon is where they had different gods. So they came to an understanding, but we're going to have this one God that ain't going to fall upon this Roman Pantheon. He's going to be a supreme deity. Go ahead.
Beginning, in all likelihood, before the mythic conversation date of... The mythic conversion date of 312. And continuing even after his revealing letter of 313.
We're going to read what that letter was. Go ahead.
His soldiers, going from victory to victory, would have redoubled their devotion to the charm of their Christian standard. That Constantine's full embrace of a Christian identity and of martial sponsorship by the Christian deity took place gradually and not all at once.
Right, so he did this real slow. Even the military men, in order for them to follow Constantine, we'll get to him and read it before I say anything. Go ahead.
And not all at once, as in the legend, is revealed by the fact that Sol, the pagan sun god, continued to be honored on Constantine's coins until 321.
Right, so that was one of his things too. Constantine, he worshipped the sun god, but when he came into effect, then he started making it mandatory. even with the military. But it was something that took place that he say tied him to the Lord. And we're going to read what that is. Not now. Now let's go to Exodus 31 and 12. And we just wanted to see that in history, that this Sunday worship, this goes back to Babylon, but it was picked up by the kingdoms as time went on. And we're still up under this time of the, we still up under Sunday worship today. You know what I'm saying? Everything from Christmas all the way to Easter, that still involves worshiping the sun. But the Lord told us to keep the Sabbath day. Okay? So let's keep the Sabbath day as a perpetual covenant throughout all our generations. We're going to read that. Exodus 12. I mean 31.
31.
Pick it up at verse, yeah. Exodus 31. And pick it up at verse 12.
And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak thou also unto the children of Israel, saying, verily my Sabbaths ye shall keep.
Right, so it says, verily my Sabbaths ye shall keep. That's with an S on it. Go ahead.
For it is a sign between me and you throughout your generations.
Until Constantine comes.
Throughout your generations.
Right, so it's a sign between me and you throughout your generations. Go ahead.
That ye may know that I am the Lord that doeth sanctify you.
That's right, come on.
Ye shall keep the Sabbath. Therefore, for it is holy unto you.
Uh-huh.
Everyone that defileth it shall surely be put to death.
Everyone that defileth Sabbath, the Lord says, should be put to death. Go ahead.
For whosoever doeth any work therein, that soul shall be cut off from among his people.
That's right. Go ahead.
6 days may work be done, but in the seventh is the Sabbath of rest.
That's right. Go ahead.
Holy to the Lord. Whosoever doeth any work in the Sabbath day, he shall surely be put to death.
Keep on repeating himself. Go ahead.
Wherefore the children of Israel shall keep the Sabbath, to observe the Sabbath throughout their generations, for a perpetual covenant.
Go ahead.
It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed.
Right, so the book says it is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever as a perpetual covenant. That means forever. It don't end. All right, so you got to understand when you're dealing with Sunday, when you come into the Word of God, you start coming to doing what the book says, you got to let that go. All forms of Sunday worship, you have to let that go. The Lord tells us to speak one thing, and then you have Satan speaking the opposite of what he said. And that's what we're dealing with today, brothers and sisters. All right, so now let's go over to Exodus chapter 20. The Sunday is a pretty easy one. You know, like I say, we in the Word, we understand, but you know, there's a lot of people that's coming in, and they don't know, you know, I think we had to figure it out. What was the true day of worship once we came into the truth? Well, before we came in, we was trying to figure it out when we were searching. However, you have to understand that once you come into the Word of God, you have to come in all the way and do exactly what He said. You can't hold on to the things of the world. You can't try to squeeze no Halloween in, try to squeeze Christmas in like we used to. I mean, we got to the point, matter of fact, I think when we saw Jeremiah 10, we let Christmas go, but we still was, if I'm not mistaken, we might have lit. I think the following year we didn't do Thanksgiving. We didn't do it. We came together, but we didn't have Thanksgiving. It's just that everybody was off, so my cousin invited us over, so we let that go. But we still was accepting money for Christmas. You know what I'm saying? You just hold the toys or whatever, and we'll come get them later on. You know what I'm saying? But you know, you gotta let all that go. And Christmas, whether y'all know it or not, it has nothing to do with the birth of Christ. It's all about worshiping that Son. Okay, so all they did was took that, put the name of Christ on it, and put it on Easter, and say he rose on the first day of the week, and that's a lie. The book said he was gone before the end of the Sabbath. Mm-hmm. All right, so let's go a little further. Let's go to Exodus 20 and verse 1. What it said, bro?
And God spake all these words, saying, I am the Lord thy God, which have brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage.
Go ahead.
Thou shalt have no other gods before me.
So we see the Lord say, thou shalt have no other gods before me. Come on.
Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image.
You shall not make unto you any graven image. No images. No riding around with a fish on your car. No crosses. No Buddha. No images. No Allah. No going over to Mecca, kissing the rock. None of that. The Lord say no images. Go ahead and read.
or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above.
That's right.
Or that is in the earth beneath.
And all this is talking about any representation. Mm-hmm. All right, go ahead and read.
Or that is in the water under earth.
That's right. Nothing. Go ahead and read, brother. I want to just read that right. Read it left.
Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them.
Why not?
For I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children until the third and fourth generations of them that hate me.
Right, so by the time we ended at the fourth generation, then you think that the jealousy of the Lord, you know, wouldn't be kindled against us. But once we got to that third or fourth generation, that sin was still going on. So the Lord added another third or fourth generation. At the end of that fourth generation, sin still going on. We still worshiping other gods. All the way up to where we at right now. Mm-hmm. Yep. Whenever you stop sinning, that's when the Lord going to bring in this punishment off of us. But we've been sinning. At the end of every third and fourth generation, we keep on sinning. So we keep on extending the time period to whoop Israel and the world. So let's go with Leviticus 26 and 1. Leviticus 26 and verse 1. One verse. One verse. Go ahead and read, bro.
Ye shall make you no idols.
No idols.
Nor graven image.
Nor graven image.
Neither rear you up a standing image.
That's right. No standing images. Go ahead.
Neither shall ye set up any image of stone in your land to bow down unto.
Right. So in the land of Israel, are they going up to what they call it? The wailing wall? Mm-hmm. That's a stone. They go over there and bow down to it, kiss the wall, and all that type of stuff. They go over to Mecca, they go over there, they have to make that voyage before they die, and go kiss that kiss that rock. Go ahead, read.
For I am the Lord your God.
Now, we see that. No graven image. Let's go look at let's go over to 1 Corinthians chapter 10. First Corinthians chapter 10, and pick it up at verse 14. 1 Corinthians 10 and 14. Nathan, you got that book? You got that school book, Doctrines? Mm-hmm. Open that book up for me right quick. And I want to read something because I want y'all to make sure y'all pay attention to what y'all kids are learning in school. Everybody that watch us online, that check on our page and stuff, make sure y'all pay attention, especially if you're coming into the Word of God, because you can be so gullible that you think everybody, you know what I'm saying, has the mindset to serve the Lord. But you got to understand, Satan is running to and fro on this earth seeking whom he may devour. At some point, if we don't get to see the coming of the Lord, then we're going to pass away. But guess what? The kids are going to come up after us. And if you don't train them, then they're going to go down the same way most of our generation was taught. But I want y'all to see something that was in my daughter's school book regarding Sunday. Before we go into this next item here, the next thing the Lord told us not to do, I want to see something. I forgot to look at it. What is it?
He would never mail a letter. The Great Stone Wall.
This is called the Great Stone Wall. Okay, go ahead. What would he not do? Now this is talking about Stonewall Jackson. Okay. All right. So go ahead.
He would never mail a letter that would be in transit on Sunday.
He would never mail a letter that would be in transit on Sunday. Go ahead.
He was a strict observer of the Sabbath.
Wow. He was a strict observer of the Sabbath. Wow. But he wouldn't mail a letter on... You see what they're trying to do?
He's trying to flip it.
They're trying to flip it. Right, go ahead and read.
And yet so many of his battles were fought on Sundays that the soldiers began to believe that he would fight on Sunday because the Lord would be even more with him.
Uh-huh. So all they do is take the Lord's name and add it to the Bible. But if you don't pay attention, this is what they feed the children. Go ahead and read.
They said he was the most ridiculous figure on horseback.
Uh-huh.
He looked like somebody of oddly assorted parts put together and all jiggling in different directions when he rode.
It must have been fair. Yeah. Go ahead and read.
Jackson is an eerie character, an Old Testament warrior.
He's an Old Testament warrior? Wow. Go ahead and read.
Who believed in smiting them hip and thigh.
Uh-huh.
After the bloody fighting at Sharpsburg, Jackson was sitting on his horse eating a peach.
Mm-hmm.
And he looked out over this field where there were dead of both sides littered all over the place. And as he was eating the peach, he said, God has been very kind to us this day.
All right, so I think that's it on that. But I just wanted y'all to see how they tried to tie him to being an Old Testament Christian or whatever, but yet still, he keeping Sunday. But y'all just have to be very careful, because that's how Satan is. He's very subtle. He's very subtle. And if you get into the mindset of the kids, then that's who you're really trying to get. You get the kids, you know what I'm saying? They do other different ways to get the children, but this is in the school book. This goes absolutely against the Bible. And the reason they can put it into people's school books, because they know people don't read the Bible. I just thank the Lord, my daughter was able to see that. Because you raised up in the way of the Lord, and they'll be able to catch this type of stuff. Alright, so let's go.
Good job.
So let's go on to 1 Corinthians chapter 10. And we're going to pick it up at verse 14. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, we're going to pick it up at verse 14.
Wherefore, my dearly beloved, flee from idolatry.
That's right, brother and sister. Flee from idolatry. Any form of idolatry, we supposed to flee from. We read earlier that what? God said, I'm a jealous God.
Right.
All
right?
When you have idols set up, whether they're in your minds or they physically in front of you, these are things that brings the Lord to jealousy and wrath. All right? Go and read, bro.
I speak as to wise men.
Uh-huh.
Judge ye what I say.
Go ahead.
The cup of blessing which we bless is not the communion of the blood of Christ.
Is it not?
Is it not the communion of the blood of Christ?
That's right. So the cup of blessing which we bless, is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? And it is, brothers and sisters. That's the cup we drink of. Alright, go ahead and read.
The bread which we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ?
That's right, that ain't nothing but his commandments. Alright, go ahead and read, brother.
For we being many are one bread and one body. For we are all partakers of that one bread.
That's right, come on.
Behold, Israel after the flesh are not they which eat the sacrifices partakers of the altar.
That's right, go ahead.
What say I then? That the idol is anything?
Absolutely right.
Or that which is offered in sacrifice to idols is anything?
That's right, go ahead.
But I say that the things which the Gentiles sacrifice, they sacrifice to devils.
You sure? That's what they say?
Yeah. Go ahead, read. And not to God.
That's right, so the stuff that's been set up in this world, the holidays, the idols that are around us, all this stuff, this was Satan, they got nothing to do with the Lord. Dealing with the Lord said no idols, no images. He gave us holy days. But notice, it also said they sacrificed to devils. Remember that, okay? We're going to look at it. Go ahead and read.
And I would not that ye should have fellowship with devils.
The Lord said he would that you not have fellowship with devils. Go ahead and read.
Ye cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of devils.
That's right, so that's what we're trying to drink from, brother and sister. We trying to drink the cup of the Lord. Not the cup, because in some instances they're talking about his wrath. We talking about the drinking of his blood and eating of his flesh. That's keeping his law, statutes, and commandments. We're not trying to do that and also worship Satan. But we're not trying to keep the Sabbath and then turn around and go to church tomorrow. You know, I'm dealing with a brother, man. Talking with a brother over the past month. And, you know, he say, man, I come to one of y'all Sabbath class, man. You know, y'all just come on over. You come to my church the next day. And I told him, man, I can't go. I just can't go up in them whorehouses, man. And he's like, oh, man, that's messed up. I just call like, yeah, I can't go up in them whorehouses, man. I just can't do it. You know, I don't mind you coming, but hey, it's like I melt like it's kryptonite or something. I can't go in them whorehouses, man. Go ahead and read, man.
Ye cannot be partakers of the Lord's table and of the table of devils.
That's right, brother. So that's why Adam got cast out. He had to put him out. He said, lest he eat of the tree of life also. So Adam ate of the table of Satan. Lord cast him out of it. Then when Christ came and died for our sins, now we're able to partake of that table again. All right? But the point here is, in verse 19, what say I then? That the idol is anything, or that which is offered in sacrifice to idols is anything. So we want to take a look at these idols, because the Lord told us no graven image. Alright? Don't rip no image or nothing. Don't make no images. Don't put nothing on your neck as far as anything that's represented in heaven, on the earth, or in the water beneath. Nothing that represents the Godhead. Nothing that represents nothing he has to do with. And you walking around paying reverence to that. That ain't what we're supposed to do. The Lord is a jealous God and he told us not to do it. So let's go look at something. Let's go over to, back over to Constantine's Sword. Pick it up at page 175. And it's probably going to be here and here. Now, this is what I was talking about when I said we're going to talk about the armies, because there was something that Constantine say happened to him, and once this happened to him, then he converted to Christianity, and then he used this to, they say, he says he used it to experiment, or this item here, to win all his wars, and then that's when his military was convinced also, and they became Christians. All right, go ahead and read.
The place of the cross in the Christian's imagination changed with Constantine.
The place of the cross in the Christian imagination changed with Constantine. Go ahead.
He said that about noon, when the day was already beginning to decline.
Go ahead.
This is Exebius' account of Constantine's own report of what he saw in the sky on the eve of battle above the Milvian Bridge.
Right, so before Constantine went to battle, he had a vision. This is one of the writer's accounts of what Constantine said. Go ahead.
He saw with his own eyes the trophy of a cross of light in the heavens.
So he saw a light in the heavens, and it was in the form of a cross. Go ahead.
Above the sun.
Above the sun. Okay. Wow. Go ahead.
And bearing the inscription. Conquer by this.
So on this cross it said conquer by this. Go ahead.
The story goes on to say that Constantine then assembled his army. He sat in the midst of them and described to them the figure of the sign he had seen. He gave them the new standard to carry into battle.
Oh, so now this cross was a new standard to carry into battle. Okay, go ahead.
Now it was made in the following manner, a long spear overlaid with gold.
Right, so it was a long spear overlaid with gold. Go ahead.
Formed the figure of the cross by means of a transverse bar laid over.
Right, so you had a long, long spear overlaid with gold, then you had a bar that went across it. Go ahead.
As we saw, the army behind this standard did conquer.
So they took this cross and they conquered. Go ahead.
And Constantine said, as Esbius heard him say, was thus convinced of the truth of Christianity. The emperor constantly made us of his sign.
Hold on, what he said with his cross, this is what convinced Constantine of Christianity. Because with this cross, he would go into battle and win the battles with this cross. So it convinced him of becoming a Christian. Go ahead.
The emperor constantly made use of this sign of salvation as a safeguard against every adverse and hostile power, and commanded that others similar to it should be carried at the head of his army, at the head of all his armies.
Right, so they carried this at the head of all the armies too. But notice what he said right here. I just pay attention to that. It says, the emperor constantly made use of this sign of salvation as a safeguard against every adverse and hostile power. Even the spiritual powers. Because notice, remember when somebody got possessed with a demon? What would they do? They take that cross and put that cross up? Okay, I just noticed that. Go ahead and read. Go get it. That next paragraph,
Some early versions of the legend of Constantine's conversation conversions had described the miraculous visions as having been not of a cross, but the...
Drop right here, that's what I'm doing. Go ahead.
Constantine put the Roman execution device, now rendered with a spear, at the center not only of the story of his conversion to Christianity, but of the Christian story itself.
Right, so he just took his so-called experience and just put the cross and just tied it to Christianity, period. So that's why you see the cross linked with so-called Christians today. Leave it open. You got to go somewhere.
193.
Go to 193. But the Lord said no images, right? No graven images.
So what we're seeing is we're seeing a man give you an account of what he saw. That's why the book tells you, woe be unto those that put their trust in man. We don't do what man says, we do what the Lord says. But the world is doing what man says. You see the crosses on the cars. You see crosses on the side of the road where people died from. That is an execution device. Mm-hmm. Go ahead and read.
Yeah, right there.
Uh-huh.
Okay. The public display of the cross as a religious symbol, especially as rendered in gold and jewels,
mm-hmm.
would be a step away from the second commandment prohibition
uh-huh.
of graven images.
That's right. The Lord said no graven images. So at least the writer knows that. Go ahead.
Indeed,
uh-huh.
a flowering of the Christian imagination
uh-huh.
would follow upon Constantine's innovation.
That's right. So his innovation came now in our imagination, what we tie to Christ. We tie that cross to it. And that's what happened when you beat it in the people. You beat it in the people, make them down this thing. Now they fear not only Christ, they really fear the cross. But now we done came down to where we at nowadays, and it's as if it's something good. The Lord say no graven images. Go ahead, read.
With an elaborate iconography
uh-huh.
that would forever.
Well, yeah.
Elaborate iconography.
Go ahead. That what?
That would forever set Christianity apart from Judaism.
Judaism. Go ahead.
But no creation.
So this cross is what separates Christianity from Judaism. Go ahead and read.
But no creation of the Christian
aesthetic
uh-huh. would surpass the satisfaction uh-huh. of the cruciform image because of his subliminal but powerful evocation of the universal.
That's right, of the Catholics. That's what universal is. Go ahead.
It should be noted that as Constantine was elevating the cross to the realm of the sacred,
uh-huh.
he was abolishing crucifixion as the Roman form of capital punishment.
So he just went on to move that cross out the way as it being a form of capital punishment. So when you did wrong, they would hang you on the cross. But he was sanctifying this cross. So while he's sanctifying this cross, he also stopping the crucifixions that were taking place on the cross. So he just slid that electric chair on in there. Go ahead and read.
Soon enough, the memory of it is true horrors would be smothered in pious stylization.
Right, so you don't, when you think of the cross now, you don't think about the crucifixion that took place. How they had so many people up on their day. I think one of the brothers read history books saying it was crucifying 500 people a day, mm-hmm. especially Israelites, 500 people a day. So as time went on, the memory of this is now gone. In order for you to understand what took place on the cross, you have to go back and look at the history of what happened on these crosses before you put them around your neck. Go ahead and read.
Once unleashed,
uh-huh.
the impulse to raise the cross will lead not only to its hanging around necks.
Okay, so once they moved it out of the way and brought the so-called good part of the cross into your mindset, then it will lead to not only hanging around your necks, what else?
At the ends of strings of prayer beads.
On prayer beads, they call them rosary beads, right?
Right.
Go ahead.
Not only to placement on the walls of churches,
uh-huh.
but to the design of churches themselves, with the imperial basilica
uh-huh.
transformed into an aspen
by an intersecting transit. Uh-huh.
Christians would recognize the cross in the human body.
Uh-huh. So notice how they recognize the cross in the human body. Every time somebody go make a touchdown, what do they do? Don't they? Mm-hmm. Don't they be in the cross themselves and do that? Okay, go ahead.
And in the tree,
go ahead.
In the way light flares,
uh-huh.
and in the conjunction of planets
uh-huh.
at the sun,
wow, go ahead.
Eventually they would see the cross.
Uh-huh.
As I do.
Where at?
In telephone poles
uh-huh.
and in airplanes flying overhead.
Right. Wow. So they see him everywhere now. But that was his account. He said eventually they're going to see the cross as I do. So you look outside, you see the, because I ain't never think, I looked at it yesterday, I was like, well, they might not have set it up that way. Like he said, as I do. He sees it a certain way. But even the airplanes, he said, you know,
the airplanes are in the shape of a cross. All right, so I wanted y'all to see that. But the Lord said no graven images. The Antichrist say we gonna put up a cross. All right, so let's go to Matthew 24. We're gonna pick it up at verse 1. Matthew 24, we're going to pick it up at verse 1. Basically, brothers and sisters, this is a history class today. You know, for what the kids are going to be coming into real soon. You know, some of the things they face. Some of the things, you know, we might need to be brushed up on. So you can say things adamantly when you tell them, no, I don't do this. Or no, I don't have that. I don't put these images in my house. I don't worship those images. And you tell them why. You know what it's for. You know what it means. You know where it came from. And you know also what's more important is what the Lord said. No graven images. Matthew 24 and verse 1. What did it say, brother?
And Jesus went out and departed from the temple.
Go ahead.
And his disciples came to him for to show him the buildings of the temple.
Uh-huh.
And Jesus said unto them, see ye not all these things?
Uh-huh.
Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another.
That's right, go ahead.
That shall not be thrown down.
Uh-huh.
And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, tell us, when shall these things be?
Uh-huh.
And what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world?
So we're talking about the latter days. Alright, go ahead and read.
And Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive
you. That's right, go ahead.
For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ,
uh-huh,
and shall deceive many.
That's right, go ahead.
And ye shall hear of wars.
Yeah, five, drop down to verse 11, go ahead. That's what he said, brother. So many gonna come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. You look at verse 4, he said, take heed that no man deceive you. All right, go ahead and read.
And many false prophets shall rise,
uh-huh,
and shall deceive many.
Go ahead.
And because iniquity shall abound,
uh-huh,
the love of many shall wax cold.
Because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. Go ahead. That's it on that one? All right. Read that again for me. Beginning of 11. What did it say?
And many false prophets shall arise.
And many false prophets shall rise. Go ahead.
And shall deceive many.
And shall deceive many, brothers and sisters. So that's where we at today. But in order for you to point these false prophets out, you got to look at what's coming out of their mouth. Or what are the doctrines that they speak? Anti is somebody that goes against. Okay? Christ said do something, they speak otherwise. That's Antichrist. Alright? Now, let's go on to 1 John chapter 2. We're going to pick it up at verse 15. What it say, brother?
Love not the world,
uh-huh,
neither the things that are in the world.
That's right. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. Go ahead.
If any man love the world,
uh-huh,
the love of the Father is not in him.
That's right. Come on.
For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes,
uh-huh,
and the pride of life,
go ahead,
is not of the Father,
uh-huh,
but is of the world.
Go ahead.
And the world possesseth, passeth away, and the lust thereof. But he that doeth the will of God abideth forever.
Go ahead.
Little children, it is the last time.
That's right. After Jesus passed away, after Jesus died on the cross and went back, we entered into this last time, brother and sister. The last days. Go ahead and read.
And as ye have heard that Antichrist shall come.
And we hear that now. Everybody looking for that now. But the world is so set on looking for one man, they don't understand what John is saying. He said, you have heard Antichrist shall come. But what did John say?
Even now,
uh-huh,
are there many Antichrists.
Even now.
Whereby we know, uh-huh, that it is the last time.
That's right. So this is how we know that this is the last time, brothers and sisters. You got a lot of Antichrists that are around the world. And see, you got, like I say, the world is looking for this one man. It is going to be one man that all the power is going to be passing to. It's already in his hand. It's going to be given to him by Satan the devil. He's going to have a certain time to rule the whole world. Until that time, brothers and sisters,
the way he's ruling right now is through all the daughters that come up out of this mother church. All the ones that are going to open up their mouth tomorrow, or will open up the table for you to eat at tomorrow on Sunday, these are ways that this doctrine, or the ways that this Antichrist is operating right now. Through all the different pastors around the world that's going against what Christ told you to do. That's why John said, even now there are many Antichrists. That's how you know it's the last time. And that's how we know this thing is almost up. Because they're running rampant. But by us looking for that one man, we're not paying attention to the preacher that sit in front of us every day. I used to be an Antichrist. I ain't the Antichrist. But all of us in here that are adults used to be anti-Christ. When you celebrated Christmas, you was anti-Christ. Easter, you was anti-Christ. Sunday worship, anti-Christ. So, like John said, even now, there are many anti-Christ. So don't get so caught up, people that just coming into the Word of God, thinking that you're waiting on this one man. It is one man that's going to come, but also look at your preacher that's in front of you. Because if he's speaking against the word, that is one of the ones that John was talking about. All right, so now, that's it on that? Mm-hmm. Let's go to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. We're going to see how far his arm reaches. He don't reach just in Christianity. He don't reach just in people finding out they're Israel. Because whether you know it or not, Satan got his hand in that too. I'm telling you, I spoke with some brothers. They speaking, they talking about the 7-year tribulation. That's the doctrine of Satan. Even though you're an Israelite and you still talking about the 7-year tribulation, you still got some of that doctrine that's coming from the Antichrist. Because the book don't say nothing about a 7-year tribulation. We can read many times where it say 3.5 years, 1260 days, time, times, and divide the times. Mm-hmm. So you got to be careful what table you eating from. All right, where we at? 2 Thessalonians?
2:1.
2, and pick it up at verse 1 and go ahead.
Now we beseech you, brother, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ,
go ahead,
and by our gathering together unto him, That ye be not soon shaken in mind.
That you be not soon shaken in mind. Come on.
Or be troubled, neither by spirit,
go ahead,
nor by word, nor by letter, as from us, as that the day of Christ is at hand.
That's right. So don't be soon shaken in mind by anything that may come to you regarding the Lord returning. It can't happen until something takes effect. Let's read what it is. Go ahead.
Let no man deceive you by any means.
Go ahead.
For that day shall not come except there come a falling away first.
That's right, brother and sister. And that's how you know we're at the end. Because it's been a falling away from the Word of God. And the whole world is getting ready to follow this beast, man. All right, go ahead and read, brother.
And that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition.
Go ahead.
Who opposeth and exalt himself above all that is called God.
That's right, come on.
For that, or that is worship.
So he called himself above God. Go ahead.
So that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God.
Now, let's go over to Constantine swore, page 16. Now the scriptures have said that he's going to show himself to be God. We also saw that he's going to think to change times and laws. But let's go see how much power he think he got. Alright? In a sense, he's going to have his power for a certain time. They're going to be given to him by Satan the devil. Let's see what he says. This is out of Constantine Swore, page 316. The highlighted paragraph.
Okay.
Can I go ahead?
Not only is Jesus the way, but the church is.
Right, so Jesus is the way, right? He said, not only is Jesus the way, but the church is. Go ahead.
Not only the church, but it is divinely established head.
But it's divinely established head. Go ahead.
If Jesus is necessary as the one robe, isn't the vicar who tends the gate also?
Right, so the vicar is a replacement. So he's saying, isn't the vicar necessary? Go ahead. The Lord said, I'm the only way. So he's saying,
Isn't the vicar necessary? The vicar is a replacement.
Go ahead. Doesn't the one who has authority over the creed of those who follow Jesus, espo facto, have authority over all?
Right. And in that mindset, it's the Roman Empire, the Catholic Church. Go ahead.
Since all are called to follow.
Uh-huh.
As I first learned from Haynes Cole, Thomas concludes as much, asserting that since it is for the Pope to define what faith is.
Right, so it's for the Pope to define what faith is. Go ahead.
It must follow that it is necessary for salvation to submit to the Roman Pope.
So in order for you to get salvation, you got to submit to the Roman Pope. You going to think to change times and laws. The Lord said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No, he said, you got to submit to the Roman Pope. Skip down to the highlighter there.
That submission is compelled by Thomas' link between the authority of the church and the authority of Christ's vicar.
And you got to read this, man. This is starting right there. Go read that.
What is that?
Right here. Boniface 8. Boniface 8.
And not only that, in Unum Sanctum, Pope Boniface VIII extends the two-sword theory.
Right, so you got a two-sword theory. Go ahead. We're going to see what that is. Go ahead.
Of Saint Bernard justifying the state's use of the temporal sword.
That's the physical sword. Go ahead.
When it is completely submissive to and under the judgment of the spiritual sword.
Okay, so you got a spiritual sword. Go ahead.
Welded by the church. That submission is compelled by Thomas' link between the authority of the church and the authority of Christ's vicar, Peter, and Peter's successor.
Right, so they say Peter is the vicar of Christ. And then the successor of Peter is not the vicar of Christ. So what they're saying is that Peter is the one that replaced Christ, because we know that the Lord told Peter he had the keys to the kingdom of heaven. But Peter wasn't no Gentile, first off. And Peter didn't replace nothing. He was a disciple. And then they say Peter's successor. So it's supposed to go down to Peter now and then go down to his people. So that's why they call him Saint Peter. Or this is why they magnified him or anointed him as Saint Peter. Alright? What it say? Go ahead. Furthermore, we declare,
We proclaim, we define that it is absolutely necessary
for salvation
that every human creature to be subject to the Roman Pontiff.
So every human creature must be subject to the Roman Pontiff. This is your Pope, and this is coming out. This is coming out of what's coming out of the history book. But this is getting ready to come into effect. This is during the time of the Inquisition. They still think the same way. We're gonna read that. We're gonna show you that the Pope in power right now, Ratzinger, wrote some laws. Stating that he think that we need to worship him, we need to serve him.
Wow.
All right, so where we at?
John.
Let's go to 1 John. No, 14. John 14. I'm sorry. John 14. There it is, 3:19 right here. There we go. Read that.
Y'all like
it? Yeah, because that's a lot.
All right.
All right, ready?
The prophetic.
All right, read that.
The prophet or head of the congregation today is Cardinal Joseph Ratzinger.
Right, they call him God's Rottweiler. All right, Joseph Ratzinger, go ahead. Now he's your cardinal. He's your pope now today. This is that guy that looks like a devil. Well, I don't know how the devil looked, but I'm saying he looked real evil. Go ahead.
To whom we have already referred, Ratzinger is the putative author of Canon 1436.1.
Right, so he's the putative author of the Canon 1436.1. Go ahead.
Of the code of canon law.
Uh-huh, which states what?
Which states, one who denies the truth, which must be believed with divine and Catholic faith.
Right, so one who denies the truth, which must be believed
with divine and Catholic faith, go ahead, or who calls it into doubt.
So if you call anything that they say into doubt,
go ahead, or who totally repudiates the Christian faith,
uh-huh,
and does not retract it after having been warned.
So if you say something against the Sunday worship, and they warn you about it, and you don't repudiate or retract what you said, what's going to happen?
It's to be punished. It's to be punished.
Go ahead.
As a heretic,
uh-huh,
or an apostate,
go ahead,
with major excommunication.
That's right, so they don't end up killing you. And they're also going to tell you that your soul is damn to hell forever, too, like they got that right.
Go ahead. This canon and others like it were added to the code of canon law only in May 1998
by Pope
John Paul II.
Right, and your other one, Joseph Ratzinger, he is now the Pope that signed a lot of these cards, these canons into law that a lot of people ain't paying attention to. So that Sunday law gonna come on the table, and it's gonna be mandatory. All right? You gonna start whooping people and start beating y'all because y'all gonna be stuck. All right, so let's go to John 14. John 14, pick it up at verse 2, man. Let's see what the Lord say.
In my Father's house are many mansions.
Mm-hmm.
If it were not so, I would have told you.
That's right.
I go to prepare a place for you.
Uh-huh.
And if I go and prepare a place for you,
go ahead,
I will come again and receive you unto myself.
That's right.
That where I am, there ye may be also.
That where I am, there ye may be also. Go ahead.
And whither I go, ye know.
Uh-huh.
And the way ye know.
Go ahead.
Thomas said unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest.
Uh-huh.
And how can we know the way?
Uh-huh.
Jesus said unto him, I am the way.
Jesus said, I am the way. Not the Son, right?
Right.
Not the S-U-N that they say the Son is what gonna save mankind, right? Go ahead.
The truth,
uh-huh,
and the life.
And the life, not the Son. Go ahead.
No man cometh unto the Father but by me.
All right, no man come unto the Father but by me, not by the Roman Catholic Church. The Lord say no man come to the Father but by me, but the Roman Catholic Church say what? You got to come through the Roman Pontiff. So this is why you got to understand, brother and sister, the doctrines that are coming out of the mouth of the ones that are going against Christ, which we know as Antichrist. All right, so let's go into Genesis right quick. Let's go look at one more of these little things. Genesis 3. Let me get to you, man. Genesis 3. In verse 17, when you get it, go ahead and read, bro.
And unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife,
uh-huh,
and hast eaten of the tree of which I commanded thee, saying,
uh-huh,
thou shalt not eat of it.
Go ahead.
Cursed is the ground for thy sake,
uh-huh,
and sorrow shall thou eat of it all the days of thy life.
Go ahead. So he said, curse is the ground for thy sake. You're going to eat of it all the days of your life. Go ahead.
Thorns also and thistles shall it bring forth to thee.
Uh-huh.
And thou shalt eat the herb of the field.
Go ahead.
In the sweat of thy face shall thou eat bread.
Uh-huh.
Till thou return unto the ground.
Uh-huh.
For out of it it was thou taken.
For out of it was thou taken. Go ahead.
For dust thou art.
Uh-huh.
And unto dust shall thou return.
Okay, so now let's go to John 6. So we see that the Lord told Adam he's going to till the ground for the rest of his life. And when he died, he's going back where?
Dust.
To the dust, right? From dust thou art, dust thou shalt return. Out of it you were taken. Alright? Let's go see what Jesus said. Because what the world says is that when you die, you go off to heaven. Or you're in purgatory. And that's absolutely contrary to what the book says, brother and sister. Alright, so now, let's go look at John 6 and verse 37. Go ahead and read, bro.
All that the Father giveth me
shall come to me.
Uh-huh.
And him that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out.
Uh-huh.
For I came down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him that sent me.
That's right, go ahead.
And this is the Father's will which hath sent me,
uh-huh.
that of all which he hath given me, I should lose nothing,
uh-huh.
but should raise it up again at the last day.
So raise it up again at the last day, go ahead.
And this is the will of him.
Now remember that, guys. That's one time, right? Raise it up at the last day, right?
Right.
One time, go ahead.
That sent me,
uh-huh.
that everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life,
uh-huh.
and I will raise him up at the last day.
Okay. That's two times, right?
Right.
Go ahead.
The Jews then murmured at him,
uh-huh.
because he said, I am the bread which came down from heaven.
Uh-huh.
And they said, is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How is it then that he said, I came down from heaven?
Mm-hmm.
Jesus therefore answered and said unto them, murmur not among yourselves.
Uh-huh.
No man can come to me except the Father which hath sent me.
He gonna do what?
Draw him. And I will raise him up at the last day.
So that's three times that the Lord said he's gonna raise him up at the last day. Why is he raising him up at the last day if they done died and went off to heaven? That don't make sense. But that's what the world tell you. Now this Jesus, coming out of Jesus' mouth, he said, I'm gonna raise him up at the last day. The last day for mankind, which what? Coincides with what? The Sabbath day. The first resurrection. That's why it's so important to keep the Sabbath day. Go ahead and read, bro.
Drop down to 46,
that's right, come on.
Not that
48.
Okay.
48.
I am that bread of life.
Lord said, I am that bread of life. Come on.
Your fathers did eat manna in the wilderness and are dead.
Uh-huh.
This is the bread which cometh down from heaven.
Go ahead.
That a man may eat thereof and not die.
That's right. Go ahead.
I am the living bread which came down from heaven.
Go ahead.
If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever.
That's right.
And the bread that I will give is my flesh.
All right. Jump down to verse 53.
Then Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, except ye eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, ye shall have no life in you.
Uh-huh.
Whoso eateth my flesh and drink my blood hath eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day.
So whoso eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood hath eternal life, and I will raise them up at the last day. That's talking about keeping his commandments. So we doing this so we can be raised up at the last day or changed in a moment in the twinkling of an eye. We understand we're not going off to no third heaven. We understand the book say from dust thou art, dust thou shall return. And he gonna raise us up, the ones who've been doing what he say, at the last day. Alright? Let's go to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Let's go look at Paul. Now we saw the beginning. The Lord said, dust thou shall return. That was Jesus talking. He came in the flesh and said he's going to raise him up at the last day. Let's see what his disciples say. Since, you know, everybody think that Paul was kicking against Jesus, even though he might have made a mistake, you know, regarding the circumcision. He is a man. Just like Moses said some things regarding marriage, the Lord came and corrected that. But you have people today that put preeminence, Paul, over Jesus. As if Paul the one that died on the cross. Not speaking against Paul, but goodness, man, you can't tell nobody nothing about what Jesus said in the Old Testament. You can't tell them what we just read about him raising people at the last day. They said what Paul said is going to be a rapture. Paul didn't say that. Paul said he's going to be caught up. Then Zechariah said he's coming down with his saints on the Mount Olivet. But they wrestle with the scripture Paul to their own destruction, like Peter said. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. And we're going to pick it up at verse 14. Let's see what Paul will say. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, and pick it up at verse 14, bro. You get it?
For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus shall God bring with him.
Will God bring with him.
And Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep.
Right, so we're not going to prevent them which are asleep. If they're in heaven, they shouldn't be asleep. That sleep is another word for them being dead. Everybody that's in that grave, where they give them the first resurrection or the second resurrection, they're getting up. So you practicing that resurrection every night you lay down and go to sleep, wake up the next day. You practice. Alright, go and read.
For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel,
go ahead,
and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first.
At that time, at the last trump, that's when the dead gonna get up. Until then, they still in the dust. Go and read.
Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds, to meet the Lord in the air, and shall we ever be with
and
the
so,
Lord. And so shall we ever be with the Lord.
Until that time, everybody else still in the dust. So we see from the mouth of Jesus in the Old Testament that from dust thou shalt return. Then we also see the mouth of Christ when he came in the flesh. He gonna raise them up at the last day. So evidently they must be in the dust where he said it was gonna be at. And then you see Paul saying the same exact thing. At the last trump, we ain't gonna prevent them which are asleep. So they can't be in heaven. But we gotta see where we get this doctrine from. Let's go with Isaiah 14 right quick. Isaiah 14. Isaiah chapter 14. And Nate, you going to Four Holidays?
Yes, sir.
I'm trying to page 12. Isaiah 14 and verse 12. And what does it say, bro?
How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer?
That's right. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, what?
Son of the morning.
Go ahead.
How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nation?
That's right. Come on.
For thou hast said in thy heart, I will ascend into heaven.
He said he's going to do what?
Ascend into heaven.
He's going to ascend into heaven. Go ahead.
I will exalt my throne above the stars of God.
And that's his whole goal. That's his whole plan to get back the way he came from. That shouldn't be our goal because we never came from there. The book says we came from the dust. Go ahead and read.
I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation.
He going to sit also upon the mount of the congregation. Go ahead.
In the sides of the north.
In the sides of the north. That's Jerusalem. And how is he going to sit there? By way of the Pope. When he get over in Jerusalem in that temple. That's how he going to sit there. Go ahead and read.
I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High.
Right, so this being, or Satan, is trying to get to where he came from. We've never been there. But yet still, we're trying to go there. But when you get understanding on the book, the Lord said he's going to raise him up at the last day. And we're going to come, we're going to meet him in the air and come back down. We're not going to meet him in the third heaven. Satan is the one that want to go back to heaven. Where he came from. And everybody that follow him want to go there also. Now let's go over the cult holidays of God's holy days. Let's take a deeper look at this. Especially as to what they're getting ready to come up into today, because this doctrine reached so far into the world that a lot of people don't really understand how far the devil got his hand inside people's mind, man. And this hand is twisted up in a lot of stuff around this whole world. Alright, so we're going to pick it up at Occult Holidays, or God's Holy Days, page 12. Okay? And go ahead and read that highlighted part. Okay, read that. I'm looking so I can see where you're at. Go ahead.
On October 31st.
A little louder.
On October 31st, their New Year's Eve.
On October 31st, their New Year's Eve. Go ahead.
Great bonfires were kindled, which were thought to simulate the sun.
Simulate the sun. The bonfires, there it is again, the sun. All right?
And to procure blessings for the entire succeeding year.
Go ahead.
The fires remained burning as a means to frighten away evil spirits. The Druids held these early Halloween celebrations in honor of Samhain, also known as Lord of the Dead.
Lord of the Dead, go ahead.
Whose festival fell on November 1st. These bonfires, or bone fires.
Or bone fires.
Where
bonfires come from, guys? Bone fires, okay? Go ahead.
Were also used in animal and human sacrifice. Thus the name. The tradition of lighting a bonfire has continued to modern times.
Right, so that's where they get the name bonfire from, a bonfire, because it was also used in animal and human sacrifice. Okay? Go ahead and read.
The Druids believed that people needed needed to be cleansed after they died. Samhain supposedly...
So how are they going to be clean if they went to the dirt? The Lord said, dust out, dust out, going to return, right? But y'all understand, you see how far Satan got his hand into the world? He want to go back. So what the preachers say? Preachers say they ain't dead. That's just their body there. But they sold them, went off to be with the Lord. I can read in the book of Leviticus, it tell you the soul that sin, if it shall what? It shall die. Go ahead and read.
Samhain supposedly condemned the souls of the departed to inhabit the bodies of animals. Kurt Koch writes in Occult ABC during the night of October 31st, the enchanted souls were freed by the Druid god, Samhain, and taken together into the Druid heaven.
Taken into what heaven?
The Druid heaven.
So they went into heaven, but the Lord said he gonna raise them up at the last day, right? Then Satan said he was gonna ascend up into the cloud. All right, now go and read that right there. Read it loud, please.
The Druids. The Druids originated the practice of hollowing out turnips or potatoes, jack-o'-lanterns, and filling them with human fat.
Listen, Diedrich. So you can find out what Halloween is about, Kenny. Okay.
Human fat.
All right. Read that again.
The Druids originated the practice of hollowing out turnips.
Right, so the Druids originated hollowing out turnips. They were inside the turnips, they would clean out the turnips and do what, Nate?
Or potatoes,
go ahead.
Lanterns.
Or lanterns. Sand. I mean jack-o'-lanterns. Y'all heard of jack-o'-lanterns, right? The pumpkins. And what would they put in them?
And filling them.
Dakota. Listen, what would they put in them?
And filling them with human fat.
So they would put human fat in the jack-o'-lanterns. They would take dead people and put them inside the jack-o'-lanterns. So y'all remember that. Don't say nothing at school, okay? Just remember, okay? So you know what it is they have y'all doing in school. Pay attention, okay? Go ahead and read.
Whenever a raiding party came to a home to demand of the husband that someone inside be surrendered as a human sacrifice.
They would do what?
They would light a jack-o'-lantern filled with human fat. If the husband relented or provided one of his loved ones as a sacrifice, the lantern would tell the other raiding parties and the demonic host that this home had surrendered a human for sacrifice.
What are you at?
Wow.
Oh, okay, you're up top. Okay, right here?
No, right here.
Oh, okay, go ahead.
And that the remaining people inside were to be left alone. This guaranteed that no one else in the house would be harmed was the treat.
You're right, that was the treat.
Wow.
Trick or treat.
Trick or treat. Wow.
That's the treat. All right, because somebody, he had already, stop rocking on that chair. Stop rocking on that. It was the husband gave up
a sacrifice.
So they not going to harm him or his family, so that's the treat. But he already got harmed because he had to kill one of his family members.
Right.
Ain't no treating that. Go ahead and read.
If the husband refused to surrender one of his loved ones, a trick would be placed upon the house. The members of the raiding party would draw a large hexagram using human blood on the front door. They got the blood or the hexagram from a dead body, which they dragged around with them.
Y'all hear this? This is what they celebrate, but that's why the Lord told the Samaritan woman, you know not what you worship. We know we worship for salvation and of the Jew. And all this stuff, man, it goes back even further than we know it. All right, so let's go a little further. Let's go to page, that's 15, right? All right, start up there.
The general practice of the Christianized Roman Empire.
it's still the Roman Empire. They just put Christian on it. Many gonna come in my name saying I am Christ, brothers and sisters. So make sure you paying attention to that. Go ahead, read.
The general practice of the Christianized Empire was to try to convert pagans as quickly as possible.
Right, so that's what they wanted to do. They wanted to convert pagans as quickly as possible. Go ahead.
However, the pagans were reluctant to give up their false gods.
Right, so the pagans were reluctant to give up their false gods. So what the Roman Empire did, all they did was say, well, we're going to blend it a little bit. And we're going to get them to, you know, convert. But let's just keep some of their paganism. All right, go ahead.
And ancient practices.
Uh-huh.
So pagan religious practices were appropriated to, in order to encourage the pagan's conversion.
Uh-huh, and to encourage the pagan conversion to Christianity. Okay? Remember Constantine, he was convinced of Christianity once he say he saw the cross in the sky that said, go and conquer. Alright, so now he gonna make everybody else believe what it is he believed, but he did that to get power. And that's what they're using today over the illiterate folks. Even those people with the PhDs, they still on, well, they probably consider all of us illiterate. Go ahead.
This was accomplished by remaining pagan holidays.
Rename it.
And changing
names. No, read that again.
This was accomplished by renaming pagan holidays and changing their symbolism to reflect Christian things.
That's right. So all they did was took what? Sun worship, the winter solstice, and put what? Christ to it and called it Christmas. You still worshiping the sun? That's all they did. Easter, from the goddess Astarte in Africa or in Babylon, Egypt, all they did was what? Change the name, call it Easter, and put Christ on it. That's all they did. Go ahead and read. Skip down to this paragraph. What it say?
The pagan festival of the dead.
A little louder.
The pagan festival of the dead.
The pagan festival of the dead. Go ahead.
Continued to be observed until the 6th century.
Uh-huh.
When it was slowly integrated into Christian practice.
It was slowly integrated into Christian practice. Go ahead.
Pope retained the Druid sacrifices.
Where you at? What? Yeah, you skipped. Pope Gregory.
Pope Gregory the Great, 540 to 604 AD, advised the
Archbishop
of Canterbury to retain the Druid sacrifices.
So keep the Druid sacrifices along with his Christianity. Go ahead.
And celebrate them in honor of Christian saints.
So then it says, so all it did was added the Christian saints to it. You know, the saints who died and didn't have no day, we're gonna add this to it. That way, they'll accept it. Okay? So when y'all ride by these churches, y'all see them saying, we're gonna have Hallelujah night. I saw a sign coming from work the other day, and I seen the sign on the church board outside. It said, trick or treat. And I just say, man, back in the day, you know, it was kind of like the church wouldn't embrace that. But the church has become so universal now, not the church of the most high God, okay? Even the secular churches, what we grew up in, you wouldn't even think today that they would be so open with embracing the stuff that's going on now. So when I saw the sign that said trick or treat out there, I said, they just open with it now. Ain't no Hallelujah now, they just having Halloween now. So Satan is really getting into them now, but we're going to show you how he getting. Go ahead.
The Roman church first introduced All Saints Day on May 13, 609 A.D. To commemorate all those saints and martyrs who had no special day of recognition.
Right, so it's All Saints Day. They didn't have a day of recognition, so May 13 was their day. Okay, they didn't have no day of recognition, so this is going to be the day that we honor them. Go ahead.
In the 8th century, the day was moved from May 13th to November 1st to counteract with pagan celebrations.
To counteract the pagan celebrations, go ahead.
Held on that same day. By the 9th century, the Roman Church was holding a Eucharist of
Reconciliation
for those dead who had not been named among the saints. The evening before October 31st was called All Hallowed Eve.
All Hallowed Eve. That's where you get Halloween from. Holy Evening. Go ahead and read.
In the 10th century, All Souls Day was added to the Roman Catholic calendar on November 2nd. For the soul is still suffering in purgatory.
So you got souls suffering in purgatory. But the Lord said, thus thou art, thus you're going to return. But they say, it's souls suffering in purgatory. Then it's souls that's in heaven. Okay? The Lord is not the author of confusion. Okay? All right, go ahead and read.
Visiting the cemeteries.
And cemeteries.
Cemeteries.
Uh-huh.
And setting out soul cakes.
Soul cakes.
Current buns.
Uh-huh.
Wine, tobacco, and gifts for the dead became a popular practice.
Mm-hmm.
People went from house to house begging for these soul cakes.
Go ahead.
In return, the recipients would offer up prayers for the souls of contributors.
Of the contributors.
Dead relatives.
Contributors, I'm sorry. Dead relatives,
This was referred to as souling.
Wow. So they referred to that as souling. So they would go house to house looking for the soul cakes. All right, go ahead and read.
Morrow writes of the significance of the feast All Saints Day.
Uh-huh.
November 1st for the Roman Catholic Church.
Uh-huh. So All Saints Day is Hallowed Saints Day, Roman Catholic Church. Go ahead.
On this day,
uh-huh,
the church honors the angels and saints in heaven.
So they honor the angels and the saints in heaven. What saints in heaven? Ain't no saints in heaven. But leave it to the doctrine of the Antichrist, it is. All right, go ahead and read.
It is a holy day of obligation.
It's a holy day for them, not for the Most High God. It's a holy day for them. Go ahead.
This day is a great family feast.
Uh-huh, it's a great family feast. Go ahead.
It has its origin in the year 610.
Uh-huh.
When
Boniface the Fourth
mm-hmm, dedicated the Pantheon of Rome,
uh-huh,
to the Blessed Virgin,
uh-huh,
and all the martyrs.
Right, so inside the Pantheon of Rome, it was just all different gods that they had inside of. That's what the Pantheon of Rome is. All right, they worshiped all these different gods. Go ahead.
It is in special commemoration of the millions of saints in heaven.
The millions of saints in heaven. Go ahead.
Who have not been officially canonized by the church.
Uh-huh.
And thus have no special commemoration during the year.
Right, so that's what Halloween is, okay? So during this time, this is the commemoration for the millions of saints in heaven. And they honor the angels and the saints in heaven. Okay? Drop down to that right there and go and read that.
The Roman Catholic Church historical practice of appropriating pagan celebrations,
uh-huh,
and giving them new Christian names and meanings is quite universal.
Right, that's quite Catholic. Right. Go ahead. Right here, what is it?
The inflexible Protestantism.
Go ahead.
The inflexible Protestantism,
uh-huh,
of the primitive missionaries with their fury. Denunciation of the heathendom.
Right, with their fury, denunciation of heathendom. So they was kicking against the pagan festivals. Okay, go ahead.
Had been exchanged for the supple policy.
So they exchanged it for the supple policy. Come on.
The easy tolerance.
Easy tolerance. Uh huh.
The comprehensive charity.
Uh huh.
Shrewd ecclesiastic.
Uh huh. Who did what?
Who clearly perceived that if Christianity,
quote unquote, Catholicism. Go ahead.
Was to conquer the world.
Right, so if Christianity, in quotes, Catholicism, was to conquer the world, what would they have to do, Nate?
It could do so only by relaxing the two rigid principles.
Rigid. It could do so only by relaxing the two rigid principles of its founder by what?
Widening a little the narrow gate which leads to salvation.
So the books say broad is the way to destruction and narrow is the way to salvation. They said we're going to widen it a little bit.
Wow.
Go ahead and read, brother. Nate.
The Golden Bow, page 419, bold emphasis.
Okay, good. Listen, now go right here. Come on right here and read that.
Trick-or-treating rehearsal.
Listen, man, Kenny. Trick-or-treat what?
Trick-or-treating rehearses the ancient custom of people visiting neighborhood homes,
uh-huh,
on Halloween night to represent the dead in search of food.
Wow, so this is why they go house to house getting candy.
Wow.
The dead in search of food. It represents the dead going house to house in search of food. The dead don't know nothing.
Right.
From dust thou art, dust thou shalt return. Go and read.
Those who pass out candy represent the homes visited by the dead, and may also represent worried individuals seeking to appease Hecate and other nighttime terrors.
Right, so they give out the candy to appease their worrying and their nighttime terrors. Mm-hmm. Okay, go ahead and read.
Read where?
Right here.
For Satan is...
Louder, please.
For Satanists who celebrate the day
as
one of two highest holy days, Halloween is the sinister direct celebration of Satan and death.
Y'all see that?
Wow.
What is it at? It's the direct celebration of Satan and what?
Death.
Satan and death.
Huh, man? Kenny? Satan and death. That's what you take part in when you celebrate Halloween, all right? So if y'all happen to go back home, understand what it is you're taking part in, okay? Go and read.
Sacrifices are performed by a select few at the highest levels of witchcraft, covens, satanic cults, and various occult secret societies.
That's right. It's still going on today, brothers and sisters. Y'all got to understand something. When them towers fell in 9/11, those are sacrifices.
Right.
Oklahoma City, those are sacrifices. These wars and stuff that take place, these are sacrifices. The oil spill, people on the boat sacrificed, Katrina sacrificed, wars that we get ready to come into, these are sacrifices. The world is ran by Satan the devil. Go ahead and read.
At Halloween, the sacrifices of some of these satanic cults are unspeakably vicious and brutal.
Go ahead.
This includes a series of 6 weeks of rituals.
6 weeks of rituals. Doing what?
Including the slaughter of a small animal.
The slaughter of a small animal like what?
Like a bird or a cat.
Or a cat, come on.
Progressing through each week with a larger animal such as a goat. And then the murder of a small infant or child until the final night where they ritually murder not only another child, but also an adult female.
Turn the page. Come on.
Every year, there are hundreds, perhaps thousands, of missing children and young adults who are never found, nor are their bodies ever recovered.
Uh-huh.
Are these victims of secret occultist human sacrifices?
Uh-huh.
Only God knows.
Right, so that's the end of that. But I just wanted y'all to see how far this goes. And a lot of these missing kids that y'all see, a lot of the kids that y'all see, go to 95 and 96. A lot of the kids, excuse me, that y'all see on the back of the milk cartons and stuff like that, that are missing, it has to do with a lot of blood sacrifices. And because y'all don't know if y'all know anything about Bohemian Grove and all that type of stuff, but they heavily into it. They heavily into
it. Them groves.
Yeah, Bohemian Grove, where like a lot of all the political elite meet during a certain time of year, and they have sacrifice children, man. All right, so, but we also want to look at something else because we want to see how far this hand of Satan reaches, okay? Now, Christianity, they believe in going to heaven. Halloween is a celebration of what? The saints who in heaven, right?
Right.
That's what they celebrate. They say since they didn't have a day, so they call it All Hallows Eve or All Saints Day. So they pay, They pay homage to the saints who didn't have a day, and they honor the ones that are the millions of saints that are in heaven. But let's see if it just reaches Christianity. Satan covers all aspects. Go ahead and read. Well, yeah, right here.
Much of Muhammad's writings.
So now we in Islam, right? Go ahead.
In the Quran, tend to run parallel with the Bible prophecy. He speaks of resurrections, a falling away in the last days, trumpet blasts, and judgment. In Muhammad's heaven,
there's a contradiction right there, because the Lord don't speak about us going to heaven. Muhammad got his own heaven. It says in Muhammad's heaven. Go ahead.
Those who die for Allah's cause. Will reach it along with the poor. 500 years before the rich.
Right, so the poor and the ones who die for Allah's cause is going to reach heaven before the rich get there. Go ahead and read.
They will recline.
They're going to recline on couches. Come on.
and be served by handsome youths.
And they're going to be served by handsome youths? It gets better, I promise you. Go ahead.
They will drink wine from silver goblets.
They will drink wine from silver goblets.
And not get drunk.
Mm-hmm.
By the mercy of Allah, there will be no speeches.
Now, this is what it says. The Quran, in part, reads what? By the mercy of Allah, what?
There will be no speeches.
There will be no speeches where?
At these heavenly banquets.
At these heavenly banquets. Go ahead.
Instead, there will be virgins.
There will be virgins. With what, Nate?
With swelling bosoms.
With swelling bosoms.
Down.
Go ahead, read, man.
But modest gaze.
But modest, modest what?
Gaze.
But modest gaze, go ahead.
Each blessed male will have 72 of these for his reward.
Uh-huh.
And neither age, nor weariness, nor death shall mar the loveliness of these maidens.
Uh-huh.
Or their comrades' bliss.
Right. So, brothers, I wanted y'all to see how far Satan and this doctrine goes. It's not just in Christianity, brothers and sisters. Ain't nobody really reading this book. Okay? Alright, so let's go look at something else. Let's go to Mark chapter 7 verse 1. Then we got one more place after this, and that's going to be it. Mark chapter 7 and verse 1. Mark chapter 7. Let me get it, brother. Hold on. Go ahead and read. Mark chapter 7, verse 1. Go ahead.
Then came together unto him the Pharisees and certain of the scribes,
mm-hmm.
which came from Jerusalem. And when they saw some of his disciples eat bread with the foul, that is to say, with unwashed hands,
uh-huh.
they found fault.
They found fault. Go ahead.
For the Pharisees and all the Jews, except they washed their hands, often eat not,
mm-hmm.
holding the tradition of the elders.
That's right. So the tradition of the elders, that they wash their hands. Mm-hmm. They want the tradition of the Lord. Go ahead.
And when they came from the market, except they wash, they eat not.
Uh-huh.
And many other things there be, which they have received to hold, as the washing of cups and pots, brazen vessels,
uh-huh.
and of tables.
Right, these are civil laws, and there was other civil laws also that they had to abide by too. Go ahead.
Then the Pharisees and scribes asked him, Why walk not thy disciples according to the tradition of the elders,
uh-huh.
but eat bread with unwashed hands?
Uh-huh.
He answered and said unto them, Have Isaiah prophesied of you, hypocrites, as it is written,
uh-huh.
this people honor me with their lips,
uh-huh.
but their heart is far from me.
And that's what we're dealing with today, brothers and sisters. People honor the Lord with their lips, but their heart is far from them. They hear the word, but it ain't mixed with faith. Go ahead.
Howbeit in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men.
That's right, they teach for doctrines the commandments of men. All this stuff, all these days we get ready to come into, these holidays that they suck, these are doctrines and commandments of men. Go ahead.
For laying aside the commandments of God,
uh-huh.
ye hold the tradition of men,
uh-huh.
as the washing of pots and cups, and many other such like things ye do.
That's right, go ahead.
And he said unto them,
uh-huh.
full well ye reject the commandment of God.
You reject the commandment of God, that what?
That ye may keep your own tradition.
That's right, brothers and sisters. That's what they do. They reject what the Lord told them to do so they can keep their own tradition. And we are the ones that are strange. But when you do a little bit of history, you find out that they are the ones that are strange. If the Bible is the basic rule of thumb, then why all of us ain't doing what the Bible say? The book say Satan deceived the whole world. And some people are still deceived today. All right, so let's go to the last place. Revelation 18 and verse 1. Last place. Revelation 18. Pick it up at verse 1. Go ahead.
After these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven,
uh-huh.
having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory.
Uh-huh.
And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the Great is fallen.
Go ahead.
It's fallen.
Uh-huh.
And it's become the habitations of devils.
That's right. So Babylon was set up during the time of Nebuchadnezzar. Once Nebuchadnezzar died off, then you had Darius and the Medes, Cyrus and the Persian came up and took it. Afterwards, you had Alexander the Great. His four generals came and took it. Then after that, the Roman Empire came. Rise and fall 10 times. And we are in the last one today, this resurrection that's coming up. Where that's taking place, you know, right now. But this is now the Babylon that we're upon. It was just passed all the way down. So now we see the angels saying, Babylon the Great is fallen, it's fallen. Go ahead.
And the hold of every foul spirit and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird.
Uh-huh.
For all nations
For some nations.
All nations.
For all nations. Go ahead.
Have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication.
That's right. Go ahead, brother.
And the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her.
Uh-huh.
And the merchants of the earth are waxed rich
uh-huh.
through the abundance of her delicacies.
Uh-huh.
And I have heard another voice from heaven saying,
uh-huh.
come out of her, my people.
That's right. So that's what we're saying and making a plea to all of the people of the world. You see us online, you see all the brothers out here teaching the gospel, man, come out of here, my people. And no, it ain't talking about get no ticket and go to Egypt or go to Israel. It's talking about spiritually come out of her. Babylon covers the whole world, brothers and sisters. So you come out of her. You come out of the ways of her. Put down the holidays. Put down the Sunday worship, which they consider a holiday too. But that's some other time. But come out of all the ways of the world. Start keeping the commandments of the Most High God. Start keeping the holy days of the Most High God. Alright? Go and read.
That ye be not partakers of her sins.
That you don't be partakers of her sins. Come on.
And that ye receive not of her plagues.
That's right. We need to find out what that plague is. Skip down to verse 8 and go ahead.
Therefore shall her plagues come in one day.
Her plagues gonna come in one day. What is it, brother?
Death.
Death. Uh-huh.
And mourning.
And mourning. Go ahead.
And famine.
Uh-huh.
And she shall be utterly burned with fire.
That's right.
For strong is the Lord God who judged her.
That's right, brothers and sisters. So that's what we want to say to bring you all today. The different doctrines of the Antichrist. We just hit a couple of them. That's all. Because there's so many that we can't cover all of them. So we might have to come back. We'll come back and do this later. But just hope that, you know, whoever comes and watches us, that just pay attention to what's going on around you. And understand that this Antichrist is not only just in this man that's getting ready to be revealed, but it's also in the daughters that come out of this Roman Catholic Church. And anytime somebody tells you to go against what Christ said, that is anti. But the big one is coming soon, brothers and sisters. So that's the lesson. The Antichrist doctrines are many. Hope you got some understanding, and I thank you for your time.